Broadcast tonight, we're in Washington talking about President Clinton, the vote in the Senate. Joining me, Bob Woodward of the Washington Post.
There's no evidence. I'm not saying it didn't happen. There's no evidence of somebody coming out of the box and saying, President Clinton said, lie, cheat, cover up, burn documents, burn the gifts, get her a job to keep her quiet, lie in your affidavit, and so forth. All of those things are missing.
And Sally Quinn of the Washington Post.
Not one person said to me, the president is an adulterer. This is a disaster. This is a scandal. This is morally outrageous. Nobody even mentioned that as an issue.
So what was it that outraged these people in Washington?
The lying.
Woodward and Quinn, when we continue.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in Washington, D.C., this is Charlie Rose.
Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight's program is being taped in Washington before an audience of PBS programmers from around the country. On the eve of the final vote in the impeachment trial of President Clinton, we'll have a series of conversations with some people who have followed this extraordinary year in politics and in our nation's history. We begin with Bob Woodward, assistant managing editor of the Washington Post, a legendary investigative reporter who broke the Watergate story with his colleague Carl Bernstein. He's also a Pulitzer Prize winner and author of numerous books, including All the President's Men. What do your sources tell you about the rage of the president and how he has stood up under this and what he intends to do?
I think it goes up and down, and the White House kind of denied that story, saying that that Clinton really wasn't going to target the House managers or Republicans and so forth. So what Clinton's going through now is a situation where an alternative version of himself or of who he thinks he is has been presented to the American public for the last year. And I think Clinton is fighting with all of his being, saying, now, wait a minute. This philanderer, double dealer, the person who lies to his aides, the person who defiles the Oval Office or the pantry outside the Oval Office and so forth, that's not who I am. I'm really a better person than that. They are trying to define my essence that way, and I'm not. In the case of Nixon, Nixon was always saying, the writing about Watergate, people are focusing on Watergate. Why don't they write about the opening to China? Why don't they do the other things? That's who I am. And so when you're caught in that sort of situation, necessarily you're going to be angry and furious and go into a rage some moments, and then other moments you're going to say, wait a minute, I'm going to have to prove myself again. In a sense, Clinton's on his third campaign for the presidency now.
What do you know, and what do we know, and what does anyone know about what it's done to the marriage and to the relationship and how that...
Well, that's one of the stories that people are going to be writing about for years, including my former colleague at the Washington Post, Carl Bernstein, who's going to do a biography of Hillary Clinton, including Hillary Clinton herself. It's almost a Shakespearean story, and I think it's going to have many, many versions.
What surprises you most, Bob, about this president in the context of this scandal? What amazes you when you go home and you say you won't believe what...
I mean, there's so many turns that have really been surprising, but I guess the big one is if you talk to Clinton, if you watch him and you see what he's done, you realize that here is somebody who is intellectually capable of being president in a way that few presidents have been. He is truly capable of defining the next stage of good for a majority of people in this country, which I would say that's the job of the president. You can say, okay, this is where we're going. This is the next stage of good. He has the tools, but he has not done that. He has been totally derailed by these scandals, going back to the initial Whitewater investigation. And so, in a way, in a very real way, we've all paid a very big price in this
lost
country.
Lost opportunity from this man who was capable of great leadership.
Sure, these are the fat years. And everything, including the Bible, tell us in the fat years, prepare for the lean years. And he's done some things in those areas, but you know, maybe the history and maybe the books 10, 20 years from now about the Clinton presidency, if there's a big decline or something truly goes wrong, we'll look back and say, what a fool, what a shame.
I know from you and I doing a lot of programs and sharing a lot of friends that what you have done in this town is have years of friendship with people who are part of this town and some who are now serving the presidency. What's the attitude of people who know him best about this?
Well, you can't generalize. One of the things that I find interesting, and Sally Quinn pointed this out in her famous piece in the Post about the Washington establishment.
Sally Quinn is here just to take a break for a moment. She'll be coming on later, and then Bob and I and Sally will have a final conversation together, but go ahead.
But I mean, one of the very important points she made in that piece is that the people in the White House, a lot of them, not all of them, are really truly enraged by Clinton's behavior. They have not gone public. They have they've circled the wagons. They're staying with their president. But when those stories come out, the sense of betrayal and exasperation runs deepest there, the closer people are to him, because the people who are close to him, again, realize his intelligence and his capacity to do the things he meant to do.
Is it because he lied to them or had them go forth based on his promise to them, or because, how dare he put at risk the presidency in the first place by engaging in something that was so risky?
Well, I think it's all of those, but I think it's all the people who work in the White House, so many of them are policy wonks. They're just like Clinton. They want to fix Social Security and health care and all of those things, and they see that that has sunk on the rocks of Monica Lewinsky.
But, I mean, I realize, on the face of it, he seems to be going about the business of leading the country reasonably well, on the face of it. Now, if you listen to Howard Baker and others, they'll say that Nixon spent 95% of his time when he was in the midst of a crisis. Is the president spending 75% of his time on this scandal?
Well, I think he's going through the motions, and he knows that's important. And during this crisis, there've been attacks on terrorists, attacks on Iraq, and so forth.
A peace settlement in Northern Ireland, Middle East negotiation, which he played a prominent role at Y Plantation.
One of the things that I never understood about Clinton, somebody told me very recently, is he's so smart, he can move into these very complicated issues, and it's like, you know, late night at the dorm at Yale Law School.
Yeah.
He can master it in a few hours or a day and get the essentials that he needs to know to do, and he's always wandering around, picking up the phone, turning on the television, picking up the newspaper, talking to somebody. The big hurdle for people who work with him is getting his undivided attention. And it's the person who won't start their term paper until 9 o'clock the night
before.
But
what does that say? Does that say something about what? An undisciplined behavior that?
Well, of course he's undisciplined. The point is he's much more undisciplined than people realize.
And there is this point. I sat the other day with someone who knows the White House well, and he said, there is more there.
More what?
More that we don't know that would be embarrassing to the president, that will never come out.
Oh, well, I think that's true of every president, and I'm sure it's true of this president. But the the definition is going to be, you know, what we know and what we can be pretty sure of.
Now, here's what they also say, that more will come out. Once this vote is over, two things might happen. One, America might say, well, now that we know we're not kicking out the president, maybe some of our personal revulsion against this will rear its head, A. Or B, that in the end, now that the crisis is over, the story will continue and other people will be looking for it and maybe feeling freer to talk.
That's always possible. But there is an exhaustion factor. The guy who yelled from the gallery in the Senate, you know, God Almighty, let's take a vote. I think he expressed the view of many.
But does it express your feeling? I mean, are you exhausted by this story, or do you find it endlessly fascinating and only two-thirds discovering?
I would like this phase to be over.
To get on with the thing you find fascinating about the last 2 years.
Yeah, I think that's going to be important, but it's going to take whatever turn is there. The question, and it's very important for me as a reporter to be fair to Clinton. I think the hardest thing.
I want to ask that question. That's where I'm going next.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't want to speculate on television or in print about what might be there. You could logically infer there were other women. There indeed are unanswered questions about Filegate and so forth, but the independent counsel Ken Starr has said he's exonerating
the
president.
I remind you of this story about you. I read where you had said that you could write two great books if you could tell what people told you off the record, stuff that would be fascinating and create bestsellers.
Three good books.
Meaning what? The story is so much better than we know?
That wasn't just about Clinton. That was about all presidents and decades of reporting. I mean, there are things that people tell off the record, of course. And you would have to check them and you would have to pursue them. Would they change the basic definition of who Clinton is? I suspect not. It could take many, many strange turns. And you're right to dig under there, but what I say, and one of the legacies of the Lewinsky scandal, is that there is so much loose talk and speculation and raw unfairness to people, including the president. I think it's possible to be unfair to the president. And as a fact person, I want to stick to stick to him. I mean, nice try. But I don't have any, I don't really have anything that is out there that I feel, should surface now. You're giving me that very skeptical, you've disappointed me look.
No, I want to follow up on that by asking, is there some story that you are working on that could be explosive, but you can't confirm?
No, but I am doing a book on the five presidents after Watergate. Ford through Clinton, and half of this book is on Clinton. It's got a lot of new material in it, of course.
It's amazing how you start these books going one direction, you end up somewhere else.
Well, this one only got, because in a sense, Bill Clinton is the legacy of Watergate. And so his portion of the book necessarily is expanded.
Was Ken Starr fair to the president?
Sure, I think he made a lot. I think Starr made a lot of mistakes, and the story of that investigation has not really been fully told. And I hope to tell some of it in my book. Others are going to tell it, and there are many questionable actions. But I don't think it alters the truth of what Starr found out about.
What's the question that ought to be asked about the Starr investigation? If it's not whether it's fair, should it have gone down the road it went down?
Yes. I mean,
and understanding why it went down that road?
I've talked to lots of people who were independent counsels in other administrations, Carter, Reagan, Bush, Clinton. Clinton had a whole series of other independent counsels focused on some of his cabinet officers. And one of the points a number of them made is you start out covering, like Starr did, Whitewater. Then you expand your jurisdiction. And if you look at the expansion of Ken Starr's jurisdiction, it's not other antecedents or offshoots or tentacles of Whitewater. It's always about Clinton. And it focuses on Clinton. And there's a rule written out in the Justice Department that you investigate crimes, not people, that the Justice Department has over the centuries really an awareness of the power to investigate somebody is immense. If I target you, Charlie Rose, and say, I'm going to investigate you, you probably can find something on anyone. So the Justice Department says, you shouldn't do that. In the case of Starr, it was always, well, Clinton might have done this, so let's expand our jurisdiction. And to get from Whitewater to Lewinsky is real hard. The only connection is Bill Clinton. And so, in a sense, I mean, not in a sense, Clinton had his permanent, roving, independent, fully funded, unsupervised prosecutor for 5 years.
With subpoena power and the power of the federal government behind him.
And the necessity that Starr felt, which is written into law, that you will investigate fully and completely, and in a sense, leave no stone or skirt unturned.
Has it ruined his reputation, Ken Starr's? Has he come away? There's a famous quote from Clinton, I guess, that somebody said, in which Clinton said, this is between Ken Starr and me, and one of us will not be standing at the end.
Well, a lot of people have said that, including people at the Washington Post when the Lewinsky scandal broke. And if Clinton's acquitted, I think he'll still be in office. And I think we will also find out tomorrow that Ken Starr is still in office. So they're both standing. There are many intricacies in that, and that's got to be explained and investigated. And that's an important story in all of this.
Do you believe that Ken Starr wants to indict the president during his term of office?
No.
Do you believe that Ken Starr has an indictment of the president after he leaves office somewhere under whatever the legal mechanism is?
That is a question mark. But based on my reporting, I can say Starr and his attorneys have concluded they have the power, technically, to indict a sitting president. But as a matter of policy, it would be really dumb that the Constitution, that if Starr were to indict the president, he would really destabilize and disable the presidency. And the Constitution makes it clear if that's going to happen, it should be Congress through the impeachment power and a trial in the Senate. That's where Starr shipped his information, and I think as a matter of policy, he would not indict the sitting president.
Has what's happened here, for better or worse, changed the rules about the personal conduct of the president, vice president, members of the cabinet, senators, and congressmen and women?
I don't know. I mean, we keep changing the rules, and no one seems to get the message. You just have to look back to the Gary Hart fiasco, when it was found out when Hart was running for president that he had a mistress, and he dropped out, and then Hart thought there was public support for him, and so he decided he would re-enter the primaries in New Hampshire and Iowa. Few recall this, but he did that, and he got statistically 0%. Zero. Now, any politician looking at that would have to say, gee, maybe people don't like their presidential candidates and their presidents fooling around with other women.
Or they may say something different. They may say that this president somehow made some kind of compact, this idea that after the famous 60 Minutes appearance that people knew where the president was coming from, and he basically said, you know who I am, and they understood it, and so therefore they believe he's doing okay and the economy's doing okay, and so
I don't know
conventional
that
wisdom, it may not be true.
Yeah, I don't know that that's the case. If you look at the Clinton 60 Minutes interview and the outtakes, which 60 Minutes recently ran, you find that it was perfect Clinton. He said both things. He both denied the affair with Jennifer Flowers, and then when Steve Croft asked him, said, well, are you denying it? Clinton at one point said, of course I'm not. So Clinton, true to form, master of the English language like no one else, said both things. And people came away with different impressions. I was thinking, as I was coming down here today, the little simple question of who are the winners and losers in all of this.
For you, who are they?
You know who's the big loser in all of this? Oddly enough, Richard Nixon. Because what history is going to do is they're going to say, well, why did Nixon resign? Why did he have to pay this price of giving up his office? And why did Clinton stay in? Why was he acquitted, assuming that's what happened? So they're going to compare the two, and they're going to realize that what Clinton did is he lied to his aides. What Nixon did is he conspired with his aides. What Clinton did, all of his aides kind of rallied around, circled the wagons, and stuck with him. There really have been no defectors. Not Vernon Jordan, not Sidney Blumenthal, not even Monica Lewinsky. What happened in the case of Nixon? 40 people went to jail. Not only did John Dean turn on Nixon, but most of Nixon's other aides, Haldeman and Ehrlichman, in books later after they served their time in jail, said, the president conspired with us to break the law. And then we have the seasonal tapes that come out of the Nixon library. At the Washington Post, we refer to those as the gift that keeps giving. Well, and you see all of those, and you compare that with Clinton, and people are probably going to say, well, there is a reason why Clinton was acquitted, and that is that the evidence wasn't there, and there wasn't this kind of massive conspiracy, and I could sit here and I won't bore you, of rolling out some of my favorites from the Nixon tapes or the various things he did with the IRS, the CIA, the Secret Service, and so forth. I mean, Nixon looked at the government as his private province.
And used it that way.
If he'd been in this situation with Lewinsky, you know what he would have done? He would have called up the CIA and said, get her out of the country, not Vernon Jordan to get her a job. I mean, that Nixon had this idea of, my God, I've got all this power. I'm going to use it to screw my enemies and get myself reelected.
And Clinton didn't do that.
He didn't do it. He didn't. I mean, there are despicable things in the record on this, but there's no evidence. I'm not saying it didn't happen. There's no evidence of somebody coming out of the box and saying, President Clinton said, lie, cheat, cover up, burn documents, burn the gifts, get her a job to keep her quiet, lie in your affidavit, and so forth. All of those things are missing.
Back in a moment, Bob will join us in a few minutes. Sally Quinn is here. We'll talk to her about the sense of Washington and how she sees this extraordinary series of events taking place in the nation's capital. Stay with us. Joining me now is Sally Quinn. She is well known as a reporter. She made her mark at the Washington Post. She's well known as a hostess in the city. She is well known as someone who cares passionately about politics and the people who make up politics. She is back writing for the Washington Post, and the first piece that she wrote created a firestorm of controversy, a firestorm of debate back and forth about what she was saying. So I'm pleased to have her here to talk about that article and why it created so much attention and how she sees the events as they're unfolding. Welcome to this little program.
Thank you.
What was it about the piece? Tell us what you said and what surprised you about the reaction, because what you did is you spoke to, through the Washington Post, in your first piece back, a sense of how Washington, this community, this people that make it up, felt
about the scandal about the president. And you said what that created so much.
Well, it was so stunning to me, the reaction, because I thought that I had just gone out and written a sort of an analysis of what was going on in Washington. We had had so much about what people outside of Washington, outside of the Beltway, thought about Clinton and the scandal. And it was all interviews with people in Oregon and interviews with people in Texas. And they were all saying, you know, just get it over with. We don't care about this. Let's move on. And I was getting a sense in Washington that people really did care about it. And people in Washington seemed stunned that people outside of Washington didn't care, that there was a real disconnect between inside the Beltway and outside the Beltway. So I started out interviewing people here to find out why there was a disconnect and how they felt. And I have to say that I knew that people were feeling quite angry at Clinton, but I had no idea that I would find the depth of feeling that I found. I interviewed maybe 150 people. As you can imagine, I got things, as Bob was just saying to you, off the record that were much more stunning than what I got on the record. But on the record, and I think there were maybe 50 people on the record, members of the Senate and the Congress, Washington lawyers, all kinds of people in the city who, and even journalists who normally don't express their opinions, who were outraged by Clinton's behavior.
They said what to you about their outrage and what it was they felt was outrageous.
Well, I sort of broke it down into four areas. The one thing that I thought was unique was that people said, this is our home. You know, don't foul the nest. We have a community here. We really care about the community. We care about the White House. This is our home. As David Broder from the Washington Post said, he came in here and trashed the place, and it's not his place. So there was that sense of this is our community, and someone has sort of dishonored the community. And people felt that he sort of dishonored the office of the presidency, and that was something that was very upsetting to a lot of people.
You also pointed out to me in a conversation I had with you that you had not said anything about the president in that piece that other people weren't saying.
Well, I mean, I had that everybody was on the record.
Right.
Everyone was on the record.
Then why did so many columnists get so exercised about what you said?
Because, as my husband said,
ben
they
Bradley.
Just he said they just wish she'd shut up.
Ben has a way, doesn't he?
Was, and somehow I think people felt that I had outed the city in a way that I had. I mean, even my worst detractors would say, oh well, it was a candid and accurate piece, which is all a journalist can ask for. But I think people felt somehow that I shouldn't have said it. It was kind of like the emperor has no clothes, that somehow I should have kept it quiet, that was our little secret, how people felt. And I was, one of the things that I said that I think stunned a lot of people, well, actually there were two, that almost to a person, everyone said to me, this is not about sex. Now, I know Dale Bumper says when they say it's not about sex,
it's about sex.
But the fact is that most people, in fact, one person said, you know, we've all had sort of rather robust sex lives here in Washington. This is not something that shocks us.
What shocks us is lying, is what
that's
that
right,
quote said.
Exactly. I mean, I never, and all the 150 people I talked to, not one person said to me, and of course, by the way, Charlie, these conversations go on today as we speak. They're the same conversations.
Well, that's what I want to do in a minute, is find out
this
how
is
things
not
have changed since you wrote the piece.
Yeah, right. But not one person said to me, the president is an adulterer. This is a disaster. This is a scandal. This is morally outrageous. Nobody even mentioned that
as
an issue.
So what was it that outraged these people in Washington?
The lying. The fact that this was our city, that people didn't like that.
Well, the fact that he had was doing this with an intern in the White House, whatever, or B, that he went out and lied about it to the cabinet and to the friends.
Well, I mean, it wasn't the fact of having an affair. I think if people felt that he had had some nice 50-year-old divorcee who was discreet, that would not have been an issue. But I think who he did it with, her age, the fact that she was an intern, the disparity in power, how she was treated, that she was sort of shuttled into the
Pentagon. But then, are you surprised around the country how women, in a sense, still support the president?
Yes, I am, actually. I am, just simply because it's quite clear from the relationships he's had with women outside of his marriage, that he doesn't treat them very well.
Why do you think that is?
Why do you think that they're, you know, even people make the obvious choices between how feminists rallied behind Anita Hill, they didn't rally behind Paula Jones in the one case, or they didn't rally against the president
well,
in this
know,
case?
I don't know the answer to that question. I read stories where women will say, oh, all men do it. Well, I don't know, Charlie, is this true? Now, I mean, all men that I know don't do this. So,
no, of course they don't.
I can't see that. I do think that there's a certain Elvis quality here.
Now we're into insight here.
He was in Buffalo a couple of weeks ago, and there were people sort of shrieking and crying and reaching out to touch him, and there were like 15,000 people, and it reminded me of one of the last Elvis concerts that I covered as
a
young
reporter. What's interesting about that, we'll get Bob back in a minute to talk, sharing this, but it is that why have the Republicans from day one been so almost resentful of this guy? He comes to town, he's young, he's handsome, he's smart. He was part Arkansas and part Rhodes Scholar, all those combinations. But they somehow, Republicans seem to, and it was speculated by Ken Starr and others, I think in a famous Time Magazine Men of the Year award, which both Starr and Clinton were on the cover, that it was because he got away with things, that he had this Elvis thing.
That's it. It's no more complicated than that. Makes them crazy. And you mentioned Ken Starr. This was one of the other things that I think people objected to in my piece, is that I said that one of the reasons why Washingtonians were not so upset about Ken Starr, and as people didn't mention sex as an issue, almost nobody I talked to mentioned Ken Starr as an issue. As Bob said, no matter what you think of Ken Starr, the issue really was what the president did, and that's what people were concerned about, that Ken Starr is a member of the Washington establishment. He goes to the Alfalfa Club dinner, the Carabao Wallow dinner. He's head of the Lawyers Association. His children go to the same schools.
Do they still feel that way about Ken Starr today?
Well, it's not even a matter
of this vote.
This is not an issue. This is not a matter of opinion. It's a matter of fact. He is actually a part of the Washington community.
And continues to be. No one says the problem here with Ken Starr is that he didn't follow the crime. He followed the president.
Right.
Which the point Bob was making.
I know a lot of Republicans who feel that Ken Starr went overboard.
But it doesn't change his status in the community.
People like him as a person, and they think he's a nice person. They like his wife. They know his family. He belongs to all these organizations. He's a part of the community, whether you like what he does or not. But I think people were upset that I said this, that somehow I should have said he's been ostracized. But the fact is, he hasn't been ostracized.
Here is what the president, and I've been told, the president feels that Washington, official Washington, what you're part of, never accepted him, never appreciated
I think that him. They were very upset when they came to Washington. Because there had already been press reports that were somewhat negative. And I know that Hillary Clinton actually said to several friends, I don't understand why some people have written negative things and said negative things about us. They were supposed to be our best friends. Because they did have a lot of close friends, or at least people that, a lot of acquaintances.
They were, years.
Exactly, they knew everybody in town. But I think that they didn't quite understand that once somebody becomes president of the United States, they go up on a certain level where they aren't just your friends anymore. The president of the United States is certainly with the press in somewhat of an adversarial position. That's just the way it is. You don't just say, I'm going to be your best friend because I'm a journalist. You step back a bit. And other members of the establishment actually wanted to reach out to Clinton, but they were the ones who seemed so sort of off-putting. I mean, even in his inaugural speech, he talked about Washington as a city of conspiracy where people are always anxious to see who's up and who's down. And when Katherine Graham had one of the first dinner parties for him before he was actually inaugurated, and he got up at dinner and made a toast that was quite stunning, where he, in effect, insulted people about this city. And well, it wasn't as much of an insult. Yeah. It was, you know, everybody's conspiring and all of you people here. And they kind of came in and they said, we're not going to do it your way. We're going to do it our way. Well, if you think of this as some sort of a tribe, That's not the way you would go into a strange tribe
and
say, yes, because that's right. Washington is very much a tribe, and you come in and you what you do is you offer them beads. And if you don't, you're going to get little poison arrows in your back.
And
this is what happened. Instead of coming in and sort of saying, we love you, we want to be part of you, because they are, just by the mere fact that they're in the White House, they are the ultimate Washington insiders, aren't they?
Yes.
I mean, they are members of the community. And everybody here was willing to have them be and wanted to meet them and wanted to be friendly with them. But it was there
so
was
Washington did welcome them to open arms.
Absolutely.
You felt like they didn't come in and accept
there
your,
was an instant feeling of sort of antagonism from them.
Whereas Ronald Reagan, who did not necessarily have an affinity with Washington, campaigned against
exactly.
Washington, came in, and he and Kay Graham were chubby from the beginning.
They had a big party, the Reagans, at the F Street Club. They welcomed all the Washington establishment types.
You guys are so easy. No,
exactly.
It's so easy.
No, but this is the thing. This is what people don't understand. Washingtonians are dying to be in with the president. They want to be seduced. They can't wait. My God,
an
invitation to the White House.
Before we get Bob back up here to see what I should have asked, what do you most want to know?
I was actually talking to somebody at lunch today, and I said, when people used to ask me that question, I would always say the one person that I want to interview most and the one thing I'd really like to know is Jackie Kennedy Onassis. What went through her head during the presidency and after he was killed and when she was with Onassis? I mean, I would have killed to really know, and I don't know whether anyone ever will. I want to know about the marriage, the Clintons' marriage. To me, this is just the most fascinating marriage I've ever seen. I don't understand it. I don't know anyone who doesn't understand it. I will be surprised if Carl Bernstein gets to it. I can't wait to read his book. I will be surprised if anyone gets to it. I just think it's riveting. I don't know another woman who could do what Hillary Clinton has done this year.
She comes out of this with her approval never as high as it is today.
That's right. Well, I think that's another issue too.
Well,
I do think that in this country, in our culture, people do like women who are humiliated on some level. I think there's a certain sexist aspect to this. You stand up to your man and you're vilified. You stand by your man and you're lionized. So I think there's an element of that somehow women in our culture we like to see women humbled and humiliated before that we can sort of put them up on a pedestal. You just think back on some.
Do you think anybody understands this relationship? I mean, do you think her best friends understand it,
or
do you think somehow?
I know that some of her friends have said that the reason that Hillary can get through this is because she's very religious, and I can understand that on a certain level. But even so, I would think that when you see what your husband has done to your child, the pain that your husband has caused your child, that would cause you to pull away, even if you could take the humiliation and the pain yourself.
Okay. Back in a moment, Bob joins me. We will talk about the sort of milieu in Washington, the zeitgeist that exists here today. Stay with us. Bob Woodward joins me again for a conversation about Washington on the eve of this very important vote we assume will take place tomorrow morning. There is expectation that the president may very well speak after the vote. We don't know how the vote is going to go. We do have early reports that, in fact, some Republicans are saying they are going to vote for acquittal, some saying on one count, perjury or obstruction of justice, some saying on both accounts. So we'll see how that vote goes when it takes place tomorrow, and we'll see what the president says after the fact. But we are on the eve of a climactic time. As Bob Woodward said earlier, what's interesting now is what happens after that. And I want to, with Bob joining me now, talk about the sense of this city and whether he thinks anything has changed because of what's been going on here. Do you have a feeling, Bob, that anything has changed, that all this has become heralding a new time in the relationships in the city, about the way the city works, the way the political establishment works? Before I answer, I'd like to give you some beads and Sally some beads, because I think that is a marvelous image about the way a tribe and, in truth, a small town work.
Is it a small town that way? You share that idea?
It's totally a small town. It's not inside the Beltway. It's inside something one-tenth the size of the Beltway. And it's got its rituals and protocols and so forth. And I agree with Sally. The Clintons found no way to intersect with it when they held all the cards.
Why? Can you explain
Well,
that?
Their explanation is that they felt they tried and got snubbed. And I think whenever there was a story that they couldn't control or they didn't like, they took it personally rather than realizing. I mean, they didn't understand how journalists function. And our job is not to write puff pieces about anybody.
Here's what's stunning about
Let me just say, I think that they had, as I said a little bit earlier, very high expectations for their relationships with people that they had formed over the years. I think they thought, well, she worked on the impeachment committee and you know, that they had networked and they knew everybody and they knew lots of journalists and that they were going to get a free ride. I think that's what they didn't have an idea that once they were in the White House that people would be judging everything they did. And I think that they became very angry and hostile almost immediately because the reaction wasn't totally favorable to everything that they did.
But that wasn't very, I think that's true, but that wasn't very bright because they knew, that, you know, they lived through the 92 campaign, and one thing you have to say about the 92 campaign, they did not get a free ride.
Exactly.
I mean, that was a series of atomic bomb attacks. Jennifer Flowers,
campaign.
The draft, I didn't inhale, and all of that stuff. I mean, the Republican view would be that the Clintons had something to hide and that they didn't want really to open themselves up and did not want to connect with this community that would be burrowing under, and that the concealment was the motivation.
You know, when
you don't accept that, do you?
Well, I think, look, I mean, we now know there were things being hidden. And
but,
as
I mean,
you posed earlier, there are, you know, likely things hidden that we don't know
about. And they feared an association with the Washington political establishment because they thought it would be exposed? Is that what the Republicans argue?
Yeah, sure. I mean, if you are hiding things, you aren't going to want to spend a lot of time with the people who are trying to discover what you're hiding. It's very natural.
They also had, they were sort of pushing people away, even though they pretended to welcome them. I mean, pretend is probably the wrong word, but appeared to be welcoming. When David Gergen first came over to the White House, he had been in Republican administrations.
Sure.
He was a Republican, and he was in their communications director. And he suggested that they start having a group of small dinner parties, series of small dinner parties where they would have like 20 or 30 people, sort of the Washington establishment insiders, for dinner. And they had a series of these, and a lot of people went. And they always came back saying that they had a sense that the Clintons not only did not enjoy them, but that they almost resented them. And that
because?
I don't know why, but that was, we were never asked, but the people I know who, did you ever go to one of those?
No. I mean,
you're the last person you're going to ask.
Which underscores my point. I mean,
yes.
in a very limited way. I mean, why, if
you don't want to, can I interrupt you? You don't want to invite you because you're a famous investigative reporter. You don't want to invite Sally because Sally knows everybody.
but here's the mistake they made. I was thinking as I was listening to you earlier, that if the Clintons had appointed Sally counselor on co-opting the Washington establishment, literally, and said, we will give you one evening a week, and you decide what we're going to do, they could have totally swamped, because co-opting this establishment is the easiest thing. All
Bring
you have
beef.
To do, all you have to do.
I turned. I would refuse the job.
Yeah, of course.
No. But don't you agree that co-opting people?
Well, as I was saying to Charlie, it's the easiest thing in the world.
The
everybody
idea is that
wants
Sally
to be
could
around,
do that and wouldn't do it because of.
But everybody
other
wants
things,
to be around power.
Yeah.
But in your book, I think it was the Agenda, you have a quote about Hillary Clinton where she says, the Washington Post resents anybody who doesn't live in Georgetown. All the Georgetowners, that's the only, if you're not part of Georgetown, you might as well forget it. Well, it was interesting thing was that the publisher and about the 10 top editors of the Washington Post do not live in Georgetown.
Yeah.
But she had this vision. She had a view of the Washington Post as being this kind of monolithic group of people who live in Georgetown and who sit there and sort of say, you're in, you're out, you're in, you're out. It just doesn't exist.
And here's the other thing. Go ahead, Bob.
No. I mean, there are a lot of dynamics at work here. This book I did, The Agenda, about the making of Clinton's economic policy, came out in June of 94, and it showed how we now know he fixed the economy. But it had scenes in which Clinton wasn't sure what he was doing, of Hillary directing him and saying, come on, darn it, you haven't got a plan, you don't know what you're doing, let's kind of being the strategic thinker or the strategic part of Clinton's brain. It showed him getting very angry. And instead of embracing that book and saying, yeah, it was rough, we weren't sure, they were deeply offended at the people who had talked to me and told me these stories. And there was a sense of, we don't want you to see that side of us, and we want to put a plastic wrapping around it. Now you run into Clinton's economic advisors, and one of them the other day, in fact, said, you need to reissue that book. Instead of calling it The Agenda, call it It Worked. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'd be willing to do that if they could get the Riottis to buy 400,000 copies of it.
The Riottis, as you remember, were the Asians who contributed to the campaign and had some involvement within the
Charlie,
campaign.
I just want to make one thing clear, and I've said it and Bob has just said it, but people in Washington want to be friends with the president, not necessarily journalists. Journalists understand that, but even journalists love to go to the White House for dinner. I mean, this is it's a big thrill. It's the White House. They automatically have a welcoming and a friendly view of the president. The president is the most powerful person in the world, and almost everyone here in Washington needs a certain amount of access to power. It just gives you a certain cachet, for one thing, if you're invited to the White House, if you get invited to Camp David, if you have the president come to your house for dinner, for instance. This is a big ticket. So it's not that they were being pushed away by the Washington establishment. I mean, that's not what I'm trying to say, and I don't want to leave the impression that because Bob and I weren't invited to these dinners that...
And neither of you ever been to a White House dinner since Clinton's been
in
power?
Well, I mean, we weren't invited because I guess because I had written some things that they thought were negative. And I would say, by the same token, it's very easy if you're a journalist to get invited to the White House, and that is that you write something favorable.
No one had lesser expectation of being invited to dinner at the White House than I. If my wife and I got such an invitation, we would think it was a forgery. But the point is, I spent a lot of time in the Clinton White House over the years in interviewing all kinds of people there, including the president and Mrs. Clinton. So in order, I was able to do my job and get information rather than invitations, which, of course, is much more important.
All right. If you got an invitation to a state dinner to the White House, would you go or not?
Sure, of course.
Of course you go. No, this is the White House.
It's the nation's house.
Of course you go to the White House. We've been a couple of times having been invited by other people to the White House.
Sally said the most interesting story to her is the relationship between the president and the first lady. Do you share that, or is it something else more interesting to you?
Oh, well, I mean, it's a compelling story. And I suspect if you had President Clinton here laid out on sodium pentothal and interviewed him for 6 hours about the relationship, and then...
He's still
in my heart. would you love that, Sally, or not?
In many ways, what a frightening idea also. And then the First Lady for 6 hours under truth-inducing serum,
right,
and put it all together and so forth, I think one of the things you would find, they have very different views of the marriage and its strengths and its weaknesses, and there obviously would be points of agreement, but it's a much more complicated thing. And as someone said, every marriage is a mystery. The Clintons' marriage is 1,000 mysteries.
It's quite clear to me that he needs her. I mean, that he really, on some level, is very dependent on her. And I think that was evident the day of the what we're calling the victory rally, the day of the impeachment,
right,
when
right.
all the Democrats went down there. And if you noticed, he held her hand. I mean, even when they were trying to shake hands or kiss other people, she was having to sort of do it like this because,
he wouldn't let her go.
No, he would not let her go the entire time. It was kind of like that was his lifeline.
But she needs him also.
Yes, I think
so look, I think there is a genuine affection and love, and obviously they've been through a lot together. But if you could piece together the real elements of that story and how they have handled this, that would be a fantastic tale.
Are you as interested in the notion of, as Bob's saying, how does he go about whatever he's going to do as president and with her support over the remainder of the term in office to rebuild or to...
Well, it seems to me that Clinton is on some level not really happy unless he's in a near-death experience. And this really has been a roller coaster ride, and I don't expect it to change. I mean, you drop him in a barrel weighted with cement in the bottom of the ocean, and up he pops. And I have a sense that we're going to have some more incredible crises and
more stories and
more
crises.
Stories. I don't know what they are, but just knowing Clinton and the way this has gone, just when it's boy, he's
all right. Let me just
he
close.
Got out of that one. Something else happens.
Let me close with this question. Both of you know Washington. You've known all the personalities. As reporters, doesn't this make it, not the scandal itself, but these two, make your work tremendously interesting? I mean, they are, if you're a reporter, a godsend. Yes?
Yes. indeed. Simply put, but most presidents are. As I've gone back and looked at...
Carter was as interesting as Reagan. Reagan is as interesting
well,
as
they're,
Clinton.
They're different, but I've found in having the luxury of time going and back and looking at some of those presidencies, there's a lot we didn't know, and there is a way to get a very, very different perspective on it. I think the problem is that, I mean, Sally has said this is a mining town, and mining is, or it's like a steel mill, and everyone kind of is working on the same product, and I think the thing we lose sight of most is reporters is simple. These are human beings, and in the Lewinsky scandal, there's been untold anguish and pain within the Clinton family, and that pain is probably the thing we will never see or really ever know fully, and that we should, you know, as we work around and do our thing, these are real people. And obviously, and I think, in the clutching of the hand and in the eyes and in the apparent aging of Bill Clinton, you see that he has gone through some sort of emotional tornado, the likes of which few human beings ever have, and that we ought to have at least a dim perception of that.
It's been an interesting story. I mean, Bob is right. It's been endlessly fascinating for everybody here. But there has been a lot of emotion in the city as well, among journalists and among just the Washington members of the community, because people have taken different positions and people feel very strongly about those issues. And it's really, in a way, it's torn the town apart.
You told
I mean,
me that.
They're,
yeah, they're
friends.
Don't speak to friends.
Friends don't speak to friends.
Because one supports the president.
That's
the
right.
Other.
I mean, as one of my friends calls it, Clinton poisoning. That everybody's got a case of Clinton poisoning. Some have it worse than others. And it really has changed the tone of the town. So I do think that even though it's a good story, I think a lot of people are kind of exhausted by it, sort of emotionally and psychologically exhausted by it.
Well, tomorrow is an important day, I think, to see how the Senate votes and also to see what the president says and to see what the next chapter in this story is. Thank you very much, Sally. Thank you, Bob. Pleasure to have you here. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow night. Thank you.
BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.